the very Son of God, is about to shed divine blood to save me. Imagine, if you will, 10,000 angels looking down, helpless. Imagine the tears. It must have looked like rain when 10,000 angels cried. Fills the heavens on crucifixion day. They say it rained, I don't know if it's true. I can just imagine 10,000 angels crying. That would seem like rain to me and you. The angels all stood ready to take him from the tree. They waited for the words from his voice. When he asked the Father, why hast thou forsaken me? They watched the Savior die of his own choice. I've never seen 10,000 angels cry, but I'm sure they did as they stood by and watched the Savior die. God turned his head away. He couldn't bear the sight. It must have looked like rain when 10,000 angels cried. As the sun slipped away, the skies turned to gray. And when Jesus gave his all, that's when the tears began to fall. I've never seen 10,000 angels cry, but I'm sure they did as they stood by and watched the Savior die. God turned his head away. He couldn't bear the sight. It must have looked like rain when 10,000 angels cried. It must have looked like rain when 10,000 angels cried.
Good morning, saints. Good morning. Thanks, bro. I can't remember the last time I heard my brother sing. I wanted to say I can't remember the last time he sang for me, but he wasn't singing for me. He was singing for Jesus. And even though it embarrasses your pastor to acknowledge our connections, he is still driven by the desires for clarity of conscience, so, which allows me the pride of association with him. As he says, we aren't just cousins. We worked together when he was beginning, and my wife has a special place in her heart for him. Well, Jerry isn't around anymore, and Donna's brother, what's his name? Joey's actually gone. But my wife has a special place in her heart for them, because when he was doing those evangelistic sermons, they would preach and then come to my house at 9 o'clock in the night, and you know, we would drill and train and preach, and then they would sleep on the floor maybe at 3 o'clock, and then at 6 wake up and go, because they had to go to work or what, and then preach and then come back. And those were fierce times. Those were great times. Those were glorious times. You can't even believe, but it was true. It is true. And the Lord was with us. And Pastor Gittins has done all kinds of things since then. And particularly among them, he has distinguished himself as a great preacher. It isn't necessarily the best idea for me to come and preach in his pulpit. It could be embarrassing. But you came to hear the word of the Lord, and the Lord will not let you down. You will receive a blessing, even though Pastor Gittins is not preaching today. The sermon is entitled, Rasta Samson Not. And the aim of the sermon is to explain to Samson and his Rasta brethren what the real point of here is all about. The reason is because people have a right to know why locks are a good thing. They need to understand what's so great about locks. Now, given the fact that sermons involve lots and lots of words and paragraphs and phrases and sentences and silences, the demand on the saints must be reasonable. When you leave, somebody's going to ask you, what did the preacher say today? So I'm going to give you 7 words. You are free, you have my permission, you do it anyway, you have my permission to forget the sermon. But remember these 7 words. Nazarite, say that everybody. Nazarite, I can't hear you. Nazarite is just another word for committed. That's the sermon. Nazarite is just another word for committed. I'd like to invite you to preach the sermon together with me. Everybody, Nazarite is just another word for committed. Oh God, bring us to commitment, whether we have locks of hair or not at all. Bring us to commitment, in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Maybe the confusion between Samson and the Rasta brethren is Samson's fault. Or maybe not. And maybe the best way to find out is to talk with Samson about it. Judges, chapter 13. Judges is the seventh book in your Bible, if it's a regular Bible. And chapter 13 is the one that comes after 12 and before 14. Judges, everybody, Judges 13. Judges 13, 2 through 5. I'm going to read it because if you read it, you will do better than I. I'm going to skip stuff as I go along so I can finish more quickly. Not really, so we can highlight what we want to highlight and need. There was a certain man of Zora whose name was Manoah, and his wife was barren. Then the angel of the Lord appeared to the woman and said to her, "Behold, now you shall conceive and give birth to a son. Be careful not to drink wine or strong drink, nor eat any unclean thing. For behold, you shall conceive and give birth to a son, and no razor shall come upon his head, for the boy shall be a Nazarite. And he shall begin to deliver Israel from the Philistines." I hear you. I said we should talk with Samson. But this is not talking with Samson. This is talking about his mother. Of course, if I grew up in Guyana, that could be a very inflammatory thing. Don't tell me about my mother. And people will, you know, get angry. When you if you're angry and then you bring in their mother, then they'll kill you. So it's dangerous. But it's safe here. We need to come to this text if we ever expect to understand about Samson. To understand Samson, you have to start with his mama. And you have to understand the Nazarite issue. Because once we start with the long hair, somebody figures that this is just your basic Rastafarian dreadlock situation, right? Well, locks and ital. Morningstar veggie burgers. God wants some people to have more hair than everybody else. Or more veggie burgers than everybody else. That's fine with me. I mean, I'm talking about the hair. In fact, it validates me. Because if God wants some people to have more, then you can see that he intends for some to have less. You got that. So I'm okay. What else beside locks is there about the Nazarite issue? Does Samson have anything else in common with the Rasta man? Let's go back to the text. He shall abstain from wine and strong drink. He shall drink no vinegar, whether made from wine or strong drink, nor shall he drink any grape juice, nor eat fresh or dried grapes. All the days of his separation, he shall not eat anything that is produced by the grapevine. No razor shall pass on his head. He shall be holy. He shall let the locks of his hair grow long. He shall not go near a dead person, because his separation to God is on his head. He is holy to the Lord. You are sensing that the Nazarite issue is bigger than hair. It's more than locks. It is a very, very fussy business. No Häagen-Dazs, rum raisin ice cream, no Welch's healthy heart grape juice, no sun-made natural California raisins, no Kellogg's raisin bran, no Napa Valley Cabernet Sauvignon. I know you good Adventists, you don't know anything about Napa Valley Cabernet Sauvignon. The Nazarite vow is not about a Loma Linda cafeteria versus your mother's home cooking. It's about something else completely. Let's begin the chapter at the beginning. Numbers 6:1 And two, the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, speak to the sons of Israel and say to them, when a man or woman makes a special vow, a vow of a Nazarite, to dedicate himself to the Lord. Maybe the brethren were going in the right direction when they decided that Rastafarianism was a religion. I don't know how far in the right direction they went. But for the people in our text, Nazarite business is holy business. Nazarite business is God business. It's dedication business, separation business, dedication to the Lord business. I know you know a lot of people and you see a lot of dedication where you are out here. Determination not to fail. Hard training athletes. Kobe driving to the last. 58 points is not enough. 60. Determined to succeed. Brilliant medical researchers. Ambiguous Congress people. Ambitious. Ambiguous too. Another political ad. You see a lot of dedication. People going through the night because they have an exam tomorrow and they're not going to fail, so they're not going to sleep. Wannabe movie stars who come out here and live like dirt because they have a dream, an ambition. You see a lot of dedication. Maybe you're a small business owner, or maybe you're the giant in a CEO giant corporation. Maybe that is your status, or maybe you serve the CEO because it will bring you some. One way or another, we see a lot of dedication, but Nazarite dedication is different. Just about all of those that I just listed here, there, and elsewhere are ambition, ladder climbing dedications. The Nazarite dedication is different. Nazarite is an all-in, no-holds-barred overboarder for the Lord. As we said at the beginning, Nazarite is just another word for, you can't remember the sermon. Nazarite is just another word for committed. He's not a fashionista posturing with brand names, undefeated sneakers or JSLV or Brixton or whatever. She isn't picking the one that's the coolest or the most convenient or the cheapest or maybe the most expensive and sophisticated, because she is so cool or so classy. Nazarite is accepting divine stipulations. Don't drink alcohol. Yes, Lord. I know it's bad. Don't drink grapes or use fresh grape juice. They're good, but I want you to sacrifice them. Everybody all around you is in the vineyards and doing what I say you must. Yes, Lord. The Nazarite vow is living in LA, and God says, have nothing to do with the Lakers, or living where? In Oakland. And the Lord says, if I ever hear you say the word step, yes, Lord, no, Lord. I mean, no, Lord. I. Something more. Nazarite witness is neither gender specific, nor age specific, nor generation specific. Nazarite witness is a vow between you and God, between God and you. You can become a Nazarite, according to my study of scripture, in one of four ways. That's not eight, it's four. Four. And the first one mentioned in scripture, the one that lays down the rules for all the rest, is about you. You choose for yourself. You make a decision. You are dedicating yourself to the Lord in a Nazarite vow for some specific period of time. You're going to live for Jesus on his terms. When a man or woman makes a special vow, the vow of a Nazarite, to dedicate themselves to the Lord, that's the first way we know about the you yourself way. It's random. Random? Yes, random. The Hebrew says, Moses, tell the people, Ish or Isha, who makes the Nazarite vow. Your English version says, when a man or woman makes the vow. In other words, the contrast is not here between when a human being or a deity. When your Hebrew Bible wants to contrast people with animals or people with angels, people with God, the identification for people is Adam. After God made birds and bees and fishes and trees and mountains and seas and perhaps coffees and certainly teas. When God was finished making yous and me's, he was finished creating humanity. That's Adam. But when it says Ish or Isha, it's usually contrasting the genders. And here, it is not contrasting the genders. It is including both genders. So what the text is saying is any human being who makes a Nazarite vow. So that's random. You can put your name in there. James, Daphne, Paul, Lael, Horatius Jr., we can put your name in there. Any one of you, Peggy, Laura, Margaret, Pamela, Joan, Mary, Nancy might say, who determines in your soul that you will live unreservedly for God or on whatever terms God lays down. That's the idea. And because I put your name in, now you are saying, who, me? Well, I don't know if Daphne knows anything about cookie jar, but who, me? Yes, you, can't be. Then who? Number, somebody else stole the cookie from the cookie. Well, this is not about the cookie jar. It's not about stealing cookies. It's not even about venerating Haile Selassie. It is about valuing or devaluing the true and living God. It's about whether you are ready to commit or not. It's about focus on Jesus that goes all the way. So, we said that taking the Nazarite vow is random. It's random because no one is naturally excluded from taking the vow. But you know, beyond that truth, it is anything but random. The book of Amos. You finish with Daniel and all the other major prophets. You start with Hosea and all the minor prophets. Hosea, Joel, Amos. Third minor prophet, second chapter. Amos 2, 10 to 12. Amos 2, 10 to 12. And I'm going to read it again because I'll read better than you because I will leave stuff out so we can finish quickly. I brought you up from Egypt. I led you in the wilderness 40 years. I gave you the land of the Amorite. I raised up some of your sons to be prophets and some of your young men to be Nazarites. But you made the Nazarites drink wine. And you commanded the prophets, you shall not prophesy. That was awesome stuff. You think about it. Becoming Nazarite is anything but random. We said that the you yourself way is the first way you can become a Nazarite. But God says through Amos that even the you yourself way is a God himself way. He makes you decide. His Spirit works in you to will, to choose to be a Nazarite. You know, in my very first pastoral district on the quarantine coast in Guyana, I was sitting in a Sabbath school class, and one of the dearly beloved saints of the congregation was teaching the class. We used to call her Sister B. Now, I remember Sister B saying, I brought myself into this church. It was tangential to the lesson. I don't know what the point of the lesson was, but I remember that point. Sister B saying, nobody brought me in. I brought myself here. Really? Dearly beloved and venerated Sister B, you brought yourself to Christ? You brought yourself to truth? Well, Sister B was sincere, and when the trumpet of the Lord shall sound, she will wake up and he will take her to glory. But Philippians 2:13 makes it clear for her and for me and for you that it is God who is working in you, giving you the desire and the power to do what pleases him. When you buy that book or stumble upon it and start reading it, whether it was your book or not, and something in that book pricks your conscience, and you say, you know what? Yes, this is true. I need to follow it. I'm going to send in this form that they say in the last page you can tear it out and sign and fold it up and put it in, and it, I want more of this. I want Bible studies. When all of that is going on inside of your head, who do you suppose is nudging you toward eternal life? Who do you suppose is drawing you out of darkness into his marvelous light? You sit in the pew or under the tent or wherever it is you are sitting or standing, and the Spirit of God makes that call and you feel the summons to go forward. And you decide not to go forward because it will be embarrassing. Who do you think you are resisting? Yourself? When you feel embarrassed because Sharon or Nathaniel or Winston or somebody goes forward, and then there's another appeal and they go forward again, and then there's another, you're always watching, they're always showing off themselves, always going up to the front, but they ain't fooling me. Who do you think you are critiquing when the Holy Spirit lays his hand on somebody's shoulder? The Nazarite vow is random, folks. But you don't get baptized by accident. You don't commit to God without even realizing it. It is God in heaven calling. The real question is anybody listening? Is anybody paying attention? Can the good Lord find Nazarites? Yes, he knows he can find professors and teachers and psychiatrists and psychologists and in the Inland Empire. Yes, he knows he can find preachers and people to give Bible studies and collect the offering and control the media and the sound system and play the music. The question is, can the Lord find Nazarites? People who are utterly, totally and exclusively committed to him in Southern California, in the Inland Empire, in San Bernardino, in this congregation today? Or are we figuring that his work can get along quite fine without all of that overboard, exaggerated, fanatical commitment on my part? I'll be fine, and the work will be fine too. Have you heard this? Acts of the Apostles 5:60. Those who would gain the blessing of sanctification must first learn the meaning of self-sacrifice. The cross of Christ is the central pillar on which hangs the far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. If any man will come after me, Christ says, let him deny himself and take up his cross. Follow me, unquote. And that is not intended to be gender specific either. If any person will come after me, let them deny themselves. So we said that God gets his Nazarite witnesses in many ways. There's the you yourself way, and there's the mother way, like Hannah, dedicating her unborn, unformed, unconceived baby boy to the Lord as a lifelong Nazarite. 1 Samuel 1:9-11. The name Nazarite is not there, but the content of the vow is. Then there's the generational way, like the Rechabites. You read about them in Jeremiah 35. They are taking orders from an ancestor whose name we first meet through his son's association with national spiritual reform in 2 Kings 10. That ancestor, Rechab, laid down a marker for them, and they insisted on following it long after Rechab was dead. So you can come to the vow from many roads. But God says, I am behind the Nazarite vow. Those who would gain the blessing of sanctification must first learn the meaning of self-sacrifice. What is the content of the Nazarite vow beside the locks? According to Patriarchs and Prophets, page 560, God picked Mr. and Mrs. Manoah because their family was, quote, one of the few households that amid the general defection had remained true to Jehovah. And the stipulations he laid down for them began immediately with Mrs. Manoah herself. She was the first Nazarite. She was Nazarite before Samson grew locks. She was to stay clean. She was to abstain. PP 561, she must herself be controlled by principle and must practice temperance and self-denial. Principle, temperance, self-denial. That sounds to me like life on God's terms instead of my own. Learning self-sacrifice on the road to sanctification. Nazarite business is God business. Awesomely God business. The basic sense of the Hebrew verbal root nazar is separation. The word takes various prepositions that indicate separation from or separation to. In our stipulations passage in Numbers 6, it's separation to. Separation to Yahweh, verse 2. To Yahweh, verse 5. To Yahweh, verse 6. To Yahweh, verse 12. The Nazarite separates herself or himself to the Lord. Heaven makes the rules, and the Nazarite doesn't negotiate over them. Maybe some of us can't see too much light in all of that overcommitted Hannah story down there by the sanctuary. Maybe we can't see it because we don't have a Peninna tormenting us like Hannah did. Maybe life in California is heaven and we're fine already. Hannah is not in heaven. She's weeping bitterly before the Lord. She's dedicating a chicken that is not yet hatched. She is marking out a road for a chick that does not yet have an egg. Talk about overcommitment. She is deciding where the chicken will cross the road before there is an egg that will yield such a chicken. Not everybody believes in overcommitment. After all, everybody can't be Nazarite, huh? You probably know a few people who had no right to take their Nazarite vows, and as we said, they fooled themselves, but not you, huh? That's what some people in Amos' time were thinking. God says, I raised up prophets and Nazarites, but you made the Nazarites drink. You know, in the Hebrew, all of this is all the more compelling because in English, we have to say, you made the Nazarites drink wine. Hebrew doesn't need all of those words. Hebrew, the verb to drink, Hebrew just turns it into a way that I guess you might say means you drinked the Nazarites. It's short and compelling. Just change the binyan. You made the Nazarites drink wine. You commanded the prophets, you shall not prophesy. Nazarite and prophetic commitment were an awkward presence in Israel. And sometimes commitment, prophetic and otherwise, is an awkward presence among us, even though Israel is God's people. Good people trying to build up their nest eggs so they can retire and go to Hawaii or Redding or Eureka or South Florida. I don't know. That's where all the retirees go, South Florida. They can't afford to do it in Southern California. Be that as it may, the prophets and the Nazarites, while you're trying to lay away your little nest egg so you can retire, the prophets and the Nazarites talking about sacrifice, making people feel uncomfortable and confused, so they decide to silence the fanatics. After all, how many Sister Whites can you take? When I was growing up, that's what the young women used to say to distinguish themselves from fanatical, exaggerated overcommitment. I'm not Sister White. Make the Nazarites cut back on their extremism. Shut up the prophets. Cut back on the commitment. Fit in with the rest of us. Stop showing up everybody else all the time. Just take it easy. Chill, everybody. Everybody settle down to a nice, even mediocre, lukewarm Laodicean temperature. Meanwhile, God is sending the straight testimony and raising up Nazarites to bear it and to deliver us from that very Laodicean torpor. Patriarchs and Prophets 560, God picked Mr. and Mrs. Manoah because their family was, I quote again, one of the few households that amid the general defection had remained true to Jehovah. It wasn't Nazarites from among the Philistines. It was Nazarites that God had to pick from among his own people because his people were living Laodicea. And he sent his eyes running to and fro throughout the whole earth so he could find people whose heart is completely turned toward him. God is looking for people he can use, folks. But among God's people, there are those who are dead set against all of that commitment. Pressure from the inside, from family, from your church, from your friends, from your colleagues. Thank God for Mrs. Manoah. She wouldn't be dissuaded. Lady Manoah, the Lord says, I have some program notes for you. For you and the son, I'll give you. You see, the right question never has been whether God does have a plan for Samson. Samson and his mother are not the only human beings that God had plans for. Jeremiah I have a schedule for you. Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I consecrated you. I have appointed you a prophet to the nation. Brother Saul, I set you apart from your mother's womb. Cyrus, 150 years before you first draw breath, I call you by name. You will subdue nations. You will make King Belshazzar mess his pants. Astonishing the details of these prophecies. Well, Belshazzar is not named in Isaiah, but that the king will mess his pants is identified in Isaiah, and it happens. You read in Daniel, and the joints of his loins were loose, is a fulfillment of Isaiah. Josiah, 300 years before you are conceived, I predict that you will come to Bethel and burn the bones of priests on this blasphemous altar that Jeroboam set up. When 300 years go by and Josiah in his fervor and zeal for the Lord comes and does that, apparently oblivious, and then he sees the sepulchre there and he says, what is that? They say, oh, that is the grave of the man who predicted that you would come here and do what you just did. Huh? Isaiah 43, a voice is calling, clear the way for the Lord in the wilderness. Make smooth in the desert a highway for God. Matthew says that that was about John and John the Baptist. And John says, as for me, I baptize you with water for repentance, but he who is coming after me is mightier than I. I am not fit to remove his sandals. Then Jesus comes in fulfillment of Micah 5:2 and Daniel 9:24. 500, 5.5 centuries before he comes along. 70 weeks have been decreed for your people and your holy city to finish the transgression. Folks, Galatians 4:4 says Jesus came in the fullness of the time. The God who gave us life is not harum scarum, mamby pamby, wishy washy, hit and miss. He is programmed. And you are not an accident. And his predictions about the coming of Jesus and indicating when in the movement of history he would, and Josiah and Cyrus and Samson and all the rest, is a statement to you. God has a plan for your life. Have you been listening? Christ Subject Lessons 3:26. Not more surely is the place prepared for us in the heavenly mansions than is the special place designated on earth where we are to work for God. Unquote. God doesn't bring some people into the world for something and then other people for nothing. It's not whether or not we have felt the currents of the Spirit trying to draw us in and wash us down the tide toward the place God wants for us. It's not whether we have felt it or not. It is just whether we are ready to respond now or not. Let's go back to Samson. God had an important work for the promised child of Manoah to do. And it was to secure for him the qualifications necessary for this work, that the habits of both mother and child were to be carefully regulated. CE 232. You were born for something. I was born for something. Samson was born for something. Lady Manoah was born for something. She got instructions for her son, and he got instructions from her. She and Mr. Manoah did everything right. And yet, the desire of their hearts would not be fulfilled. Maybe she should have done a Hannah. Maybe she did a Hannah. Maybe she had spent more hours agonizing before her God than Hannah ever did, even though she didn't have a pen in a tormenting her. Whatever the case, the Lord decided to come in and let her know something. You're going to get your baby boy. Sammy, born to shine. That's what his name means. Sunshine. Mama Manoah thrills to her very core with all that God has done and is doing and will do for her through this son of hers. He's going to begin to deliver us from our enemy, the Philistines. Sunshine. God is going to brighten the whole earth through this boy. 8 days on, get him circumcised. Mr. Manoah makes sure that Sunshine gets his ID card on the 8th day, the mark that says he's Israelite. 40 days along, Mrs. Manoah brings her 1-year lamb for a burnt offering and a pigeon or a dove for a sin offering. Now she can participate in her community again. She's not ritually unclean anymore. Now she can really buckle down to training her Sammy Sunshine boy. She's going to train him up in the way he should go. She and he share weird food. Mr. Manoah can eat stuff that they cannot eat. He can drink the Welch's Healthy Heart grape juice. He can eat the Kellogg's Raisin Bran. They have to try oats and water. She loves it. It's wonderful to live a life that is marked not just by avoidance of evil, which is what self-denial is. Sometimes we as Christians blend self-denial and self-sacrifice. Self-denial is denying the fallen self, its cravings and lusts and desires. Self-sacrifice is giving up stuff that is good for some divine purpose. So she loves living a life of sacrifice for Jesus. She teaches him to sing the commandments. She teaches him to stay away from people who may be ill, even his own relatives, because if they die and he's near there, it will violate his vow. Staying away from the grape juice is hard, because grape juice is everything in Israel. When Israel is at its height during the time of Solomon, the historian says everybody was under his own vine and his own fig tree. That it's like saying we were at the zenith of. But Sammy notices that the grape juice has different effects on different people. So mommy has to explain the difference between grape juice and grape juice, between wine and wine. And every time she does, she adds something about how special you are to God, my dear Sammy. Explains how he's going to do all kinds of things for God, and God is going to give him grace and power and wisdom and strength. And so God says, I want to highlight myself in you so you don't follow the normal track, so that people will know it wasn't because of the grape juice that you became what you became. They will know that even though you didn't do this and that, that everybody says you got to do, you did those and these that nobody else had ever done. Everything goes well. Judges 13:24 says the Lord bless him. He grew up to fulfill God's plan to do the life work thing that God had programmed for him. Then Sammy fell in love. You know the story. It's kind of odd because it's hardly part of the commitment Nazarite vow sermon, but this is about Sammy, so what shall we do? Cut it out? The scripture keeps it in. Sammy falls in love with Phyllis from Timnah, the beauty queen from the neighboring Philistine town. He is all hunk and she is all legs, and everybody except mommy and daddy can see that they were made for each other. And when they beg Sammy to go to PUC, go to La Sierra, find a nice girl, Sammy says, Mom, this woman is gorgeous. You ain't never seen anything so sexy in church in California. Ain't it true, Mom? Mercy. Sammy born to shine. Sammy comes to the place where he can't see a skirt and not follow it. And if they stopped wearing skirts, he still knew what he was following. And his Nazirite vow? What becomes of the commitment? What about God's plans? This Sammy story, folks, is proof of the power of your choices. The question has never been, does God have a plan for me? It has always been and always will be. Am I willing to cooperate with God? Will I run with him and win the race? Am I ready to be a Nazirite? Or am I scared? Because Nazirite is just another word for... Nazirite is just another word for... committed. Am I? Are you going to just ignore the Spirit's voice in your ear? Just silence his plans and his counsel? Just go off in some direction that will bring you money and fame and never mind? Are you committed? Will you commit today? Are you willing to decide, as God keeps calling, decide to quit the vacillation and two timing and give it all to the Lord who has already given all for us? In the horror of the incarnation, where the King of Glory came to be a human being, and the disgrace of the crucifixion, where he's murdered, assassinated, stark naked, body brutalized between two criminals. His own choice, my brother's song said. Are we willing to stand with Jesus? Or do we prefer the average mediocrity of the Laodicean temperature? All around Mamma Manor were Israelites, but most of them were born of the will of the flesh. God is looking for somebody who can show that the Spirit is present, born not of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. God is looking for somebody who will stand out for him. Are you willing to stand out for Jesus? Are you willing to be a Nazirite for Jesus? You understand the thing about the locks now? The thing about the locks is not to measure who has more dreadlocks. It is to show those who are committed, because no matter how they turn, they could not hide. Are you afraid to stand out for Jesus? When they grew those locks, everybody, anytime, anywhere they were, who saw them, knew who they were. In the farm, in the bedroom, in the classroom, at the bar, in the store, in the hospital, everywhere you saw, you know, that's a committed person. Are you afraid to stand out for Jesus? Is that why you shave? What's wrong with being conspicuous for Jesus? What's wrong with being Nazirite? Nazirite is just another word for committed. Committed to Jesus, who is committed to you, who for the joy that was set before him endured the shame on the tree. You know, Sammy Sunshine in the end killed more people in his death than he did in his life. He made another decision to come back. I know that all of us make decisions and then make them again and then make them again, and we do it every new year at least until we stop doing it because it makes no sense. But the Sammy story is really a glorious salvation story, because it says even though God had a plan for you and you lived 30, 40, 50, 60 years and didn't follow it, you can turn around and say, okay, Lord, take me now. It's never too late to look to Jesus. It's never too late to start over. It's never too late to commit. It's never too late to choose to be Nazarite. Because Nazarite is just another word for committed.